Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Welcome back to Cinephilia. It is a week later from our Rise of the Skywalker episode.
Yes.
And we're here to...
go over the best, or not just the best, but all of the films in 2019. The best and the worst. Just a year in review.
Yeah. So what do you think? Was it a good year for movies?
2019? You know, it's funny. I started out thinking that it wasn't, but then it ended up being pretty okay. Yeah. There were a lot of movies that I enjoyed this year.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, that was okay. I mean, most exciting thing for me was Star Wars.
Yeah.
But even then, that was...
Star Wars... All right. Star Wars is about medium
for
me. There are a lot of things that I loved a lot more than Star Wars, and there are a lot of things that were a lot...
I actually saw something today that I really liked.
Oh, what was it? Do you want to wait for you? Is that going to be your recommendation, or...?
We'll get that.
It's been a good year for movies in the theater. It's been a good year for movies streaming.
Streaming has been a lot.
Yeah. And even not just movies, but streaming shows has been really good this year, too. First, before we get into news, we should get into some other stuff. What do you have to say?
I was going to say, I didn't set up a chat monitor for us.
Oh, yeah. We can't see the chat right now. You guys are saying.
I'm going to bring you up on my phone. I'll keep tracking.
Well, I hope you guys are there, and I hope you guys are chatting away.
Literally, right before we started the show, I said, I hope I didn't forget on either.
And I said, I hope you don't either.
And that's it.
And wasn't even looking up to notice that there's not chat right in front of me.
Hardliners here. Yeah, I was like, something's missing. I don't feel, there's nothing in front or next to me. Nope, I found you guys. Hardliner says, I'm here. Kenwood says, free for all.
Free for all.
Nope, I got you guys. I'm waiting for the ad to finish so I can turn off the video part. And just have channel leave.
Here, I will do mine as well so I can refer to the chat too.
So what do we want to talk about first?
Well, first we should do our news and trailers.
No, but you said before we get into the news, but there's something we should talk about.
No, I was asking because you were starting to say something, but it was about Twitch.
Only thing is that tomorrow night... We're having our New Year's Eve stream. Tomorrow night, starting at 7 p.m.-ish Pacific. We're going to be hanging out here in the studio all the way till our New Year's, and you know, at 12.
Yes, that's when the New Year does start. But you mean the West Coast New Year.
West Coast, that's what I meant to say. I need you to shut up. We have audience members today. Danny and Brian are like wandering about the studio.
As well as Dave.
So yeah, we're gonna have our stream, New Year's Eve stream. Come join us. It'll be fun. It'll be very hangouty. We're gonna play some games, maybe do some Twitch things, and we have a bunch of people coming over just hang out. So yeah, we'll see what happens. We've never done a five hour hangout party stream before.
Yeah,
we'll see if that's entertaining. I don't know.
I'll be stopping in. It'll be your chance to see me outside of the movie realm. I'll come in and play some games and hang out.
Kevin would say hourly midnight countdowns starting for the East Coast. Oh, well, yeah, we're gonna have hourly countdowns. Yikes. We might have
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was in the thing. Did you know?
That's what that means.
Yes, that's what that meant. We'll talk about it later. Yeah. So we'll do countdowns for every coast so that everybody can join in the fun. So that was it. That's it for this week, and then it's the end of a decade.
End of a decade. So tonight we're doing 2019 in review. But next week, we're going to do the decade in review. We're going to go through, you know, more than just this year. The last 10 years.
We are getting old, because now we can review decades.
Yeah.
That used to seem like such a foreign concept to me. Now I'm old enough that I can review a whole decade. That's sad.
Just wait till you can review a century.
I hope I can review a century. That'd be great. See, I think it's only that, like, middle part of your life where you feel old. At first you feel fine because you're young, and then you feel old, and then you get way old and you don't care. You're like, whatever, I made it this far.
What age is the way older you don't care?
I think it's different for everybody. I'm thinking like
for you,
70s.
For you it's going to be 70s.
Yeah, because I feel like in my 60s I'm still going to be working hard and be like running around. But when I get 70s I'm be like, I'm out. I'm done.
Retirement?
No, I don't think.
Because I feel like retirements don't really exist anymore for people.
I don't think I could. I would be bored out of my mind. I don't know how people are going to retire. Unless you, like, have a bunch of money and go, like, travel. Then that would be my retirement, if I could travel.
You'd still want to do stuff.
I would still make it. I would not stop working. I'm never going to not work.
That's how I always feel when actors or, like, artists say they're retiring. I'm like, this is like a passion thing. Art is like a passion thing. You don't retire from that. And then, of course, people like Miyazaki always come out of retirement because they can't.
You can't. Yeah, you can't do anything. Because that's what happens. You either come back or you die. Don't know so many people you know who are like retired. They die like soon after they retire. That's true. They're like stuff in life.
Our 2019 episode is going to be very morbid.
Yeah, I'm not gonna talk to people who died after the tiger. It's gonna make me sad.
So yeah, let's get into news and trailers.
Let's get into. Where's the button? Let's get to the news. The news. You like that?
Ta-da!
Ta-da! The news. So what's in the news?
So I was just reading earlier that Sid Mead has died.
So who?
Sid Mead. Am I pronouncing it incorrectly, or you just don't know who it is?
I don't think
he's a designer that worked on like Tron and Blade Runner.
Okay.
So a lot of science fiction. He's a big science fiction.
How old is he?
Guy. He was. He also did a lot of video games. He was. See, the article I pulled up is just a gallery of his work. It doesn't actually give me the information. He worked on Star Trek and Aliens and...
Well, then he's probably pretty old guy. Oh, Hardliner. Thank you, Hardliner. He says... Hardliner 86. Says he's 86, yes.
Oh, Hardliner beat me to it, but I did find it in my article.
He was 86 years old. Man, that's a lot of work.
Yeah, yeah. So...
Did he just retire?
I don't know.
He probably just retired like this year.
Well, let's see. I mean, he's been working... He worked on Blade 2049, so... He's been working up until this point.
He probably retired. That's probably the last move. You retire, you die. Blade Runner. Not Blade. That's a different movie.
Did I not say Blade Runner?
I said Blade. Did you? I don't know. One of us did.
He said Blade
2049. So RIP to Sid Mead.
Oh.
Also in the news.
Ooh, Harlana says, Mead passed away at the age of 86 just a few months after his announcement in September that he was retiring after spending 60 years in the design field.
Really?
You retire, you die. If you're a creative, you die.
You're so proud of that.
No, just tell him, don't retire. If you're an artist or creative, don't retire. Because you're going to die immediately afterwards.
You just heard that this guy retired and then died and you're doing football games.
No, that was correct. That was correct.
Also in the news,
warning to all.
If you share your streaming service passwords,
ooh,
there are some things happening, some things in the work.
The cops are coming to your door.
Well, at the Consumer Electronics Show in the UK, a company unveiled their new system that they're working with Netflix and Amazon Prime to try to, tell... You know how, like, algorithms work? They kind of learn, like, what you're doing in your system.
Yeah, yeah.
And so this new system is going to try to tell whether or not what you're watching is being watched by more than just you. So that if they assume that you're not the only person using your password, there will be some sort of lockdown.
Huh.
It's weird.
But
it's a weird way to go around it because it's sort of like the Minority Report. Like, how do you effectively know for sure that that's what's happening? And they could just like be making assumptions about things.
Yeah, like what if I watch stuff here at the studio because I'm signed in into my streaming services here on the Apple TV that we have here, and then I have it at home.
Right.
I guess I can't be at two places at the same time.
But some services, I don't know if maybe services will change this, but some services allow you to have, like, a family account, so family members can use it.
Yeah, yeah.
So how do they know, like...
I mean, it's algorithms.
...who's
and...
in your family and what's allowed? Like, it's a weird thing. And I guess this is in the early stages, but just know that they're working on some sort of crackdown for us to not be able to share passwords if that is what you do.
Is that what you do?
I don't share my password to anyone. I use other people's, but I don't share my password. So that's happening. Also in the news, the director of Crazy Rich Asians has... what's that face for?
Let's be paying attention.
he's put a shout out to Disney Plus saying, let's do a Rose Tico show.
Yeah.
And he wants to direct it. That'd Disney be cool. Plus has not responded, but he has made that public that he's interested in doing it. The director's name is John M. Chu.
John M. Chu.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually,
so he's interested in doing a Rose Tico show for Disney Plus.
Andrew sent us an article about the director, one of the writers, the guy who wrote the movie with JJ, about why Rose Tico wasn't in the movie.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I guess according to him, he explained that they had meant for her to be on not our nurse, but in the Rebel base with mm-hmm. it had a lot of scenes with Carrie Fisher. And so apparently they wrote her as, they wanted to take one of the characters that was one of the known characters that they had developed. And so they chose her, put her in there. She was supposed to be like the grounding of whatever area. And she had a bunch of scenes that I guess ended up not technically working out. So she ended up getting cut because they couldn't get the things to look proper.
That really sucks.
And that sucks, yeah.
Do you think that that's true or that they're doing some...
I don't know. It's hard to tell. Because it's also hard to, like, figure where the hell you're going to fit her. Like, right. There was already a bunch of characters. And
they keep introducing more characters.
Yeah, and the characters they introduced didn't really do anything. So it's not like we could have just gone, oh, we didn't need this character. Rose Tico could have done that. She didn't... I don't really know what else she could have done. Like, I feel bad because I really like her. Yeah. But I don't really feel like we missed out on much. Because I don't know that she had anything more to give us, per se. But I do wish that she had been in the movie a little bit more.
I still stand by, this is not our Star Wars episode, so spoiler if you haven't seen it. I'm not going to go into details, but I still stand by that Kylo Ren and Rey are really the only characters that are fully fleshed out in this trilogy. Yeah. Like, everyone else just got sidelined, mm-hmm. and it sucks, because there are a lot of other characters that could have been so cool, but they all got sidelined.
Yeah. I don't know. JJ should have made all three movies. Would have been fine. Ken would say, I mean, it's like, says, I feel like everything the guy from Lost did, Rose could have done, lol. I guess so.
Yeah, Monahan.
And Carmen says, yeah, his excuses didn't go well either. Yeah, I don't know, nobody cared.
Yeah, because there's still a lot of stuff that Leia did, like, in the first half of the movie. And none of it was, like, interacting with Rose. It was all other people.
Yeah.
So it's, I don't know. It just felt like a weird excuse.
MediaPlex says, I don't care more about Rose's character development. Time was wisely spent on the other characters. Which I kind of see, because, like, on the representation part, I wanted her to be there. But in character, there wasn't really much for her that I really needed. Like, I really wanted them to finish the other characters. I wish she had had... I was not that interested in her. I like her. I like the character, but I didn't in this scenario. I didn't really.
So would you be interested in a Disney Plus show?
Well, she did something else.
Yeah,
because I mean, like
not
her.
Not set during like what we already saw. Because
I like her. I like Rose Tico. I like the actress. I would like to see more. But in that movie, I didn't like watching the movie. I didn't feel like I was like, oh, I missed. There was not enough Rose Tico.
Because there's so many other characters who should have been developed and weren't. Mm-hmm. And you're like, yeah, I get that. Yeah, I really wish, even outside of a gay romance, I wish that we had gotten some sort of, like, follow-through with Finn or Poe. Like,
yeah, but I did that.
Ooh, we got a follow!
Hey!
Thank you. But speaking of women in film...
Yes?
To lead off of Rose, interesting, the four most anticipated movies of 2020...
Yeah.
...in the mainstream... At least, I mean, not going into indie movies, but this, as far as mainstream is concerned, is pretty incredible anyway. Four most anticipated mainstream movies of 2020, directed by women.
Yeah.
So they are Wonder Woman 1984.
I look so good and I'm so excited.
It does. That trailer keeps getting me hype every time I see it.
I hope it's not just a good trailer.
Me too. But I mean, as far as I'm concerned so far, she's the best part of the DC mm-hmm. Cinematic universe, so... Wonder Woman 1984, Black Widow is also directed by a woman. Marvel's Eternals mm-hmm. is directed by a woman.
Yeah.
And Mulan.
Oh, Mulan's directed by a woman.
Yeah. So, and then also Birds of Prey is a big one that some people are excited about, and that's also directed by a woman. So that's a big handful.
That's a lot.
That's a healthy dose, and I hope that, because there were a lot of good movies directed by women this year, that aren't really getting recognized now that we're going into award season. So mm-hmm. I hope that, you know, women directors start getting more recognition because they're doing a lot of good work and a lot of hard work that just goes unnoticed by most.
Reed H. Cooper wants to know if we've discussed recent deaths. People we lost in 2019.
A couple weeks ago, we talked about a couple of deaths, but we haven't done an in memoriam for 2019 yet. Did you want to talk about some people?
I didn't think about it ahead of time, so, I mean, there's, off the top of my head, I don't really have many.
Yeah. I mean, we just talked about Carol Spinney.
Carol Spinney and...
And Renee Auber. I can't pronounce his last name.
Oh, yeah. From Star Trek. Odo. Well, Stan Lee was this year, right? Yeah, Stanley was this year, right?
I think
he was in 2018 then.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, we haven't. I don't think we are, because we didn't prepare for that.
I think the last bit of news, which is a little funny thing to end on, is that I hope you guys had a Merry Christmas, by the way.
Yeah.
Happy holidays. Happy Hanukkah. Martin Scorsese's daughter trolled him.
Oh, I saw that. That was great.
By wrapping his Christmas gifts in Marvel wrapping paper, which is funny.
That's great.
Yeah.
She gets it.
That's it. I'm sure he can laugh at himself about it, too.
Media Plug says, whenever someone famous dies, I take their age and subtract mine and panic. Does anybody else do that? I'm gonna start doing it.
And now that it happens in threes, does he do it like every time in a succession of three?
And then you like get the average of that.
You get the average. Your lifespan just keeps dwindling down.
Yep.
This much. So that's it for the news, I believe. Yeah. That was a quick little news session.
I have Last Starfighter is getting a sequel.
What?
Did you guys hear that? Last Starfighter is getting a sequel. And Art and Danny gasp.
I love this Last Starfighter.
Same.
But I don't know that it needs a sequel.
Well, I heard that there was going to be another movie, but I didn't know if it was a sequel or a remake.
Gary Wheaton, I guess it's a sequel. Confirmed developing follow-up to Last Starfighter with the original writer Jonathan Bettel.
At least the original writer will be involved.
How do you sequel that? I don't
know. Gonna Jumanji it. Now it's on a PS4 disc!
So, we'll see. Alright, let's move on to, I remember where these buttons are. Let's move on to trailers.
Trailers. I don't think I've seen any of the trailers you have set for us.
No, I only have two trailers today, because apparently there's nothing right now.
Well, I mean, we're in the week between Christmas and New Year's, so it's like, it makes sense that there's there are things happening. What's happening?
Oh, hi.
I want to watch trailers.
All right, this trailer is called Downhill. It is a trailer for a Will Ferrell movie.
Mm. Will Ferrell still making movies?
Yeah.
Wunderbar.
Thank
you. Your hand in the air. Arms up like this. Happy family.
Please look into the camera. Please just smile.
He wants poles up again.
He
wants us to keep doing poles up. I don't know.
Is that Julia Louis-Dreyfus too?
I think so. Just been through a lot lately. My dad passed away.
It's a shame. 8 months ago.
So we came here.
He's still here.
He's still here.
You lose a parent and the ticking gets louder.
Every day is all we have.
We have, yep.
Powerful.
Maybe we ski the beast after lunch.
Pete.
I don't think it'll be that challenging. It'll be fine.
Is that okay?
Yeah, it's fine.
It looked like it was gonna kill us.
The descent
moment. The kids were screaming because it felt like we were gonna die.
Hey, it's that guy.
Pete? Wow. And I look over at Pete, and he had grabbed his phone. Pete left us.
Life's
I didn't leave you to be buried.
I'm gonna win.
I ran to get help.
Yes, I'm gonna win.
That's not what happened.
When I choose to survive.
I love my family.
Every day is all we have!
How could I run away in ski boots?
What?
Can you run in ski boots?
Not very well.
Boom. Exactly.
Regardless, I wouldn't leave my family to die.
That's boom. Yes.
You have a right to be angry. It's black and white.
Well,
no, it's black and white. How old are you?
30.
Oh.
There's only one thing I have to worry about right now, and that's going down.
Understand why there weren't any warnings posted anywhere.
There was a warning.
What?
Posted at lifts, gondolas, hotel receptions, restaurants, shops, bars, soda machines, toilets.
We didn't see any of that.
Well.
Well, wow. Oh, Valentine's Day. Well, I'm glad it's not like old school slapstick Will Ferrell. Like he's doing a little something more. It's not Bewitched. It'll be better than Bewitched, for sure. Wait, Danny, there's another trailer.
Oh, no. And she says she lost her passport. And she's panicking.
Oh, no.
I'll help you find it, Mitchie. I mean, if you're going to get stuck, might as well get stuck in Cancun area.
Is that where Mitchie is right
now? Find the nearest embassy or consulate. That's what we had to do in Italy because Val's passport got stolen day one, 3 hours off the plane.
You can get a new passport in like a day, right?
You can get a temporary one in a day, but yeah, you got to make sure you make time and go do that because it can take anywhere from like 20 minutes to an hour or two. So if that is the case, if you can't find it, just look for a consulate.
I feel like Danny's head should be a new character in the show. You should be dressed like Jambi, though.
You can just grab a chair.
You need like a genie turban.
All right. We have another trailer. One more trailer.
Oops, that's there's no signal for that trailer.
I fixed it. Here we go. This is called Woman in the Window. So the description said it was very much
like Rear Window.
Rear Window, yeah.
A lot of people try to be Hitchcock. Let's see.
I'm Anna Fox.
There are some things that need to be said
about me.
Amy Adams.
I have an anxiety disorder.
I live across the street. My mom asked me to give you this.
I'm not prepared for visitors. I'm a agoraphobic. I can't go outside.
Let some of the outside come in. Your neighbor from across the street.
Pretty sure you're not supposed to be taking these without a hall.
I was just thinking, Julianne Moore might be great in this role, and then she showed
up. She's become a friend.
Like your earrings.
Oh, thanks.
A gift from an old boyfriend.
Does your husband mind?
Well, our family's complicated. Jane, she's been stabbed.
NYPD.
Why is he here?
Mr. Russell believes that you made a mistake.
This cast!
I've never met my wife.
We spent the evening together.
I'm Jane Russell.
She's not Jane. I know what I saw.
Your doctor said that your meds can cause hallucinations.
Why are you protecting them? They're all hiding something. Her earring, it's in their house.
You're playing with the wrong family.
Do they know you're here alone?
911?
I think somebody is in my house.
Don't go looking into other people's houses. You won't like what you see.
Oh, that looks interesting.
That does.
I'm sad they gave away that twist, though.
Yeah.
Maybe that's not the twist.
I actually don't think the trailer is that great, but the movie looks like it'll be good.
Yeah.
And I'm happy that we're getting better crime thrillers. Crime thrillers are like seem like they're on the rise.
William H. Cooper, I think, disagrees. He said, this feels trite. I don't know.
I think that I can see how that could be read from this trailer, but the cast is
good. Yeah,
is making me think that it'd be a little better than Trite. Maybe a lot better than Trite. Hopefully, a lot better than Trite. So,
cool. What's up for trailers? Let's get on to the main event.
How should we talk about our 2019 movies? Like, should we go from like the worst to the best?
Let's go the worst. Let's start with the worst.
How many movies have you seen this year?
Not many.
Could you guess?
Not many.
I've seen like 105.
Yeah, I'm really bad at watching movies. Welcome to our movie show. I don't watch movies. I need to make time for movies. 2020 is the year that I make time for movies.
Is that your resolution?
Yeah, my resolution is to watch a movie a week.
That's good.
I don't know if it's going to happen.
It
can happen.
I usually watch at least, on average, a movie a day.
See, the thing is, I am not capable of watching a movie while doing something else. I have to sit and watch it.
It depends on the movie for me. Like, a good movie, I can't do something else.
Yeah.
But I will oftentimes put on a movie and then figure out, like, okay, this is like... I just got The Beach Bum from Netflix DVD, which is a movie that came out this year. And I put it on, and like 5 minutes into it, I was like, yeah, I need to be doing something else because this movie is awful. Or if we want to start off at the worst movies of the year, then Beach Bum is pretty down there.
I'm also planning to read a book a month. So I don't know how watching movies every week and reading a book a month is going to work out for me.
See, I'm a movie watcher, but I'm not great at reading. I will read, but very... Reading puts me to sleep. If I read, then I need to read a little bit, like before bed or something like that.
Yeah, I just need to make time for it. I feel like I don't make time for it.
Yeah. Self-care.
Also want to play more video games. But I also can't make time for it. Yeah, 2020 is not looking great for me.
So, of the movies that you've seen that you can think of, what was like the worst movie that you can remember?
This year? The worst movie I saw this year is when I bought the Blu-ray for Last Jedi.
I mean, new 2019 movies.
I've talked my head. I don't know.
There were a lot of Disney live action remakes.
Lion King was pretty bad.
Lion King was pretty bad.
And it made me sad because it was beautiful.
But it wasn't the worst.
It wasn't. No.
Did you see Aladdin?
Oh, you know what? I kind of liked Aladdin a little bit more than I liked The Lion King.
Where did I put it? I have Aladdin lower than Lion King.
Really?
Wait, where's Lion King?
Is it
Lion
top?
King not on my... No, it's not.
I just saw it.
It's not.
Oh, I thought that was Lion King.
Oh, yeah. See? That's at the bottom. I have it. So Lion King is lower than Aladdin for me.
Okay.
So, yeah, actually Lion King is the worst... I take it back. Lion King was the worst live action.
Wait, was Dumbo this year?
Dumbo was this year. There were a lot this year. There was Lion King. There was Aladdin. There was Dumbo. There was Lady and the Tramp on Disney Plus. And they were all pretty bad. Dumbo was awful.
I think Dumbo was I want to say the worst movie ever.
The only reason Dumbo tipped a little more for me than Lion King is because the characters, I mean, none of the characters emoted in Lion King. They just... And then, like, the musical covers were awful. Timon and Pumbaa were great in Lion King.
They were great.
They were funny. Lion King was just badly put together.
Hardliner hated Glass.
Glass is actually, like, around the B area.
Yeah,
like, not an A movie, but it was a B.
It was okay.
Mitchie
liked Aladdin. She said Aladdin was so good. I did like Aladdin. Out of those three, I liked Aladdin the best.
I have Lady and the... Out of those three, Aladdin is the best, but Lady and the Tramp I have just above Aladdin.
I lost interest on that very quick.
Yeah, it doesn't mean it was good. No. It was just better than Aladdin, in my opinion. The big problem that I had with Aladdin was that it felt like a recording of a stage musical. Everything was so flat and staged that it didn't feel like we were actually watching a movie of what was happening in the world that they were creating. So it felt... flat the whole
The director movie. Of the movie was pretty bland.
Which is weird because the director of Aladdin is known for his, like, crazy action.
And then he didn't.
Yeah, he didn't.
Probably because he was working for Disney. And they told him what to do.
Exactly. I must say, above all of those as far as Disney live action movies, even though it was a sequel that did not need to happen, the Maleficent sequel was better than all of those.
Was it?
Yeah. It was decent. It wasn't great. But
what was your worst movie?
My worst movie right now, and it's funny because I let me change the rating of this because I need to sort it. For most of the year, my worst movie of the year was Birthright. I mean, not Birthright. Brightburn.
Oh.
And I talked about that earlier in the year when we did our Brightburn episode. Just because it was sloppy, but it also had a lot of social commentary that was anti-progress.
Yeah.
So it felt like it was just like kind of a dangerous film. But just in the last week, I watched two movies that were worse than it. So The Beach Bum, which is one that I just mentioned that is touted as a comedy, starring Matthew McConaughey and Snoop Dogg, and I feel like you need to be high to enjoy this movie, and I wasn't, so it was not funny at all. You're basically watching Matthew McConaughey as a beach bum destroy his life, and it's supposed to be funny, but to me it was like sad and off-putting.
Mm-hmm.
And then also a movie titled The Field, which is a weird little sci-fi movie that I don't think many people have even heard of. Which had like a what's happening?
I'm adjusting focus because I realized when we moved the couch, I didn't adjust focus.
Oh. Is it supposed to look like that?
Oh, no.
That's why I was asking what's happening.
Fixed it.
So, The Field is like this weird little sci-fi movie that has an interesting premise, but then everything else about it is awful. Like, the acting's awful. The special effects are horrendous. And it's a sci-fi movie, so there's a lot of that. Huh. It's just...
What was it called again?
The Field.
The Field. I didn't watch that at all.
No. I don't think many people did. I don't remember it even coming out in a theater. It might have been direct-to-video. I rented it on Hoopla, which you can get for free if you have a library card. So those were... The Beach Bum and The Field are probably my worst movies of the year. And I've seen so many people talk about how great Beach Bum is. Like, that's why I added it to my Netflix DVD queue, because people were saying, this is really funny. Martin Lawrence is supposed to have, like, a really funny scene in it, and I didn't think it was funny. it was just a mess.
One of the other movies that I actually really hated this year, and I cannot for the life of me understand why it's getting so much praise, is Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
I still haven't seen it.
I really did not like the movie. It wasn't like, oh, it's not my cup of tea. I like literally was not interested. Literally the last 10-15 minutes of the movie are interesting.
But yeah, it's a long movie, right? It's so you have to sit movie. Through so much to
There's
get
a
to
a lot
that.
Of nothing. There's a lot of just like really good acting from the two through DiCaprio and Brad Pitt.
Yeah.
But that's like it was boring.
I'm still interested in seeing it, but I didn't see it in the theater because of the length, and I was just like I need to sit at home and watch this one. So I'm going to watch it at some point. I'm not avoiding it like I did other movies this year. But it just wasn't... it didn't seem interesting.
No. Tarantino just needs to retire.
and not direct a Star Trek movie?
No, I was excited for him to direct a Star Trek
but
movie.
But he's not now.
Now he's not. Now I'm like, now I don't care.
Well, if we're... Go ahead.
It's just like Tim Burton. They sort of hit like a thing, and they think they're the greatest people in the world, and they go...
Because they get into their own, like, niche.
Yeah.
Like, they can't think outside of...
Yeah.
Of, Tim Burton has just become like a joke of himself. Like a parody of himself.
It is a parody of himself.
Yeah. Which is why Dumbo was awful, because it was basically Tim Burton phoning it in and pulling from other movies that he's already done, because that's what he's known for, like what's recognizable to him. So he's going to take clowns from here. He's going to take some of the plot from Big Fish. He's going to take some of the set design from Batman Returns. It's like, and just put it together and then let whatever happens, happens. And it was awful. But if we're talking about long movies that people are now praising, and I just did not, I could not get into. I would talk about The Irishman.
Oh, I wanted to.
It's like over 3 hours long.
That's too way too long. Too slow paced.
Did you watch it?
I started to, and then I was like, done.
Yeah, it's, you know, Martin Scorsese is known for his, you know, movies, his big mob movies with this same cast. And so it's a winning combination, but for some reason this just...
It's a lot of the same.
It's a lot of the same.
And it's probably good. It's probably filmed really well. It's probably... But it's a lot of the same. It's this, you know, a lot of the same Martin Scorsese stuff.
Yeah.
And like...
Did you make it far enough to see any of the de-aging stuff?
No, I don't think I did. No.
Okay. The de-aging was... some of it was really good, but some of it was weird. And I think the weirdness for it comes from the fact that these are older actors being de-aged. And when you're...
For long terms, too. For like longer chunks of the movie, not like little like...
Yeah, but not even like... Like the look of the de-aging looked fine, but it was... Older actors who were still acting as their older selves, but being young characters. Like, you just move differently when you're young than when you're old. And I don't think, like, physically they looked like they should be young, but they moved like they were old men. So then there's, like, this weird uncanny valley between the two that I don't think worked. And then another movie that I'll also bring up, because you said you didn't like Once Upon a Time in Hollywood because... of its length, but also that there were good performances. It just wasn't an interesting movie. And as far as good performances not being an interesting movie, I'm going to have to say Marriage Story.
I haven't seen that, but apparently people love it.
All three, Irishman, Marriage Story, and Once Upon a Time in Hollywood are being like praised as some of the best movies of the year. Marriage Story has incredible performances. Adam Driver and Scarlett Johansson and Laura Dern are all incredible in it. As much flack as I give Scarlett Johansson, she is a good actress. But I just don't want to watch two people like be mean to each other during a divorce. That's what the whole movie is. They're just being selfish and mean. And I understand that might be a realistic thing. People might actually go through that. But this director has made all of his movies about that. It's like Martin Scorsese making all his movies about mafia. At some point, you got to branch out and do something else, or it's just going to become repetitive.
Yeah.
No matter how great the performances are. So, I'm just not seeing it for those movies. A lot of people, other people are.
Martin Scorsese directed Hugo, right? That was the movie?
Yes.
That's when he did something interesting. We did something that was great. Completely outside of his normal stuff, and it was great.
Yeah.
That was a really cool movie.
I was having a conversation with someone about Hugo recently. We were talking about who the audience for that actually was, because apparently... A lot of people think that it's a kids movie, but I feel like because of the pacing of it and because of the fact that it's about old Hollywood and old movies, I think a lot of it actually just goes over kids' heads.
Oh, yeah.
So it's definitely a movie for like people our age who are film fans.
Yeah.
Like, we get into it.
Yeah.
But for some reason, that movie is always categorized as a kids movie.
Yeah.
It doesn't work as a kids movie.
It's about kids.
Yeah.
But it's not necessarily a kids movie.
So, let's talk about, there were lots of superhero movies this year. Let's get into some of those, because the worst superhero movie this year by far had to be Hellboy.
Oh, Jesus Christ, that was terrible. Like, in a sad way.
Because like, you had hope for it.
You had hope for it. I really wanted it to be good, but Hellboy, just blah. Thomas Hayden Church? Was the only thing exciting about that movie that I thought was cool.
He's great. I don't even remember him.
He's the... What's his name? Lobster or something?
Sandman? Oh, Lobster Johnson? Lobster Johnson.
Lobster Johnson.
But he's barely in it,
he's
right?
barely in it.
So that's why I was like, I don't even remember it was that Thomas Hayden...
Yeah, he's in it for like a minute. And then you're like, oh, the one person I was really interested in. And
I was also looking forward to Hellboy because they finally cast... Daniel Day Kim, an Asian actor, as an Asian character. And it was a big hoopla because they originally cast a white actor. And he, you know, dismissed him. Was like, once he found out that the character he was playing was originally part Asian, he was like, I'm out of here. You guys hire an Asian actor. So they actually had to put he actually put pressure on them publicly to cast an Asian actor, and they finally did, and then the movie sucked. And then the movie sucked. It was like, well, at least something happened. At least it was a stepping stone as far as that.
There was nothing great about this movie. Not even, I would say, like, you know, we say some of the, like, you got good performances.
Yeah.
The performances weren't even great.
No. Mm-mm. So that's towards
the Mitchie's throwing bottom. Punches because she's out of the country. She said Endgame was pretty bad. Hashtag no apologies.
For me, Endgame was the best superhero movie.
Yeah.
It's Endgame I actually have in my top 20 for the moment.
Okay.
It's not in my top 10, but it is in my top 20.
Both Spirit Channels and Kevin would say they skipped Hellboy too.
Yeah, there's no... You're fine skipping Hellboy. There's no reason to...
Mitch is still in the U.S. Oh, she hasn't left yet. I thought she was already over there and lost it over there. Oh, sorry.
Well, that's good. I mean, that's probably a better situation to be in.
No, that she can't leave to go on vacation.
Oh, well. But at least she's not stuck somewhere.
I'd rather be stuck... Whatever.
So not that movie related. The episode that we reviewed, Hellboy, we also talked about Shazam, which was...
Oh.
A little better than Hellboy. It wasn't amazing, but it had a lot more potential than Hellboy.
I was entertained. I think it was the first time I've gone to the movie theater in...
That was your...
Maybe ever.
And maybe that was the first time you went to the movie theater ever? What are you saying?
By myself.
Oh, by yourself. Really?
Yeah. I could... Nope, second time. Us. Us was the very first time I went to the movie theater by myself.
You went to watch Us by yourself?
Yeah, because we were going to do...
You could have gone to watch it with me.
You'd already seen it or something. Oh, okay. I don't know. I had very little time in it. That was the first
The other big superhero thing that happened this year that I feel like... It's kind of a weird thing because these two characters... I mean... Well, there's like a lineage here. There's Shazam going into Captain Marvel because they're both Captain Marvel characters.
Yeah.
And then there's Captain Marvel going into Dark Phoenix because those two movies are basically the same movie. And I feel like Captain Marvel, Dark Phoenix, I'm sure there are people who are going to hate me for saying this. Captain Marvel, Dark Phoenix are interchangeable in the fact that I don't think one is necessarily better than the other. As much as people hate X-Men movies, Captain Marvel was not better than Dark Phoenix. And they both, I think, were better than Shazam, though. I'm sure. There's a lot of people who are, like, just done with X-Men movies, and I'm one of them, which is why it was surprising to me that Dark Phoenix wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be.
I actually like Shazam better than I like those two movies.
Really?
It was at least funny and kind of fun to watch.
Yeah.
I was kind of bored with the other two.
Yeah.
Like, I like Captain Marvel. I like her character. I think she's cool, but the movie was kind of... Well, I would have rather had gotten one of those movies where you give me the origin story in the first 15 minutes of the movie, and then we move on.
Yeah, because this is the... Captain Marvel is... The whole movie is the origin story.
Yeah, the whole movie.
And Marvel had kind of moved past that. Like, they hadn't done a real origin story for a long time, so it's kind of...
Like...
But I guess I can understand them wanting to take time because it is the first movie they've done with a female superhero lead.
Yeah.
So I can understand them wanting to take time to build that character, but it was kind of boring. Yeah. Honestly, I think what made Dark Phoenix good to me is Jessica Chastain as the villain.
Mm-hmm.
Because she was interesting, and it also had one of my most hilarious moments in a theater this year, which was also one of the most inappropriate moments in a theater, because I really should not have laughed at this, and I shouldn't admit that I laughed at it, but the scene where she Jean Grey makes Professor X
into a puppet.
Yeah, into a puppet and walk up the stairs.
That was terrible.
It was awful. I mean, to have a character with a disability like that, you know, become the punchline of a joke just is awful, but at the same time I could not stop laughing. And then to put an exclamation point on that moment when he finally gets up the stairs and he, you know, she lets go of him and he falls down and he can't use his legs anymore. There's a close-up of his legs with Jessica Chastain walking over them. And I'm just like, really, y'all did that? And for some reason, that's one of the most memorable moments in a movie this year for me. And that's awful for me to say, I'm sure. But
Mitchie says, if you don't like origin movies, you can't like Wonder Woman. No, I like origin movies. I just didn't like that origin movie. Because Carl Ernest says, if Marvel had treated Captain Marvel like WB DC did Wonder Woman, I felt like it would have been better.
Yes, yeah. I agree. I agree.
And Kevin would say, that's a good comment here from Kevin. He says, Captain Marvel felt like a pretty good MCU Phase 1 movie to me.
Yes.
But it came in Phase 3 world.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. And it would have been great if Captain Marvel was a Phase 1 movie. Then we would have had, a female lead way back when. And it wouldn't have been such a big deal.
Yeah, it would have been fun.
But let's talk about Endgame, because Endgame, I guess some people don't like it, but Endgame turned out to be really, really, epic and had a huge climax.
It was
climax.
A nice, satisfying, end of a saga.
Yeah.
On, Star Wars managed to barely get there. I still liked it. I'm still happy. I didn't get the same kind of, that we got with Endgame. I think it was a very nice way to finish out this big long
thing. Yeah. What I think is funny is that both Endgame and Rise of Skywalker came out in the same year, and Danny called the end of Rise of Skywalker when we had our discussion. He said, I don't want it to be like Endgame where everyone shows up at the end. And they did. Happened.
They didn't linger on it. They were just like, here we are, and then we moved on.
But do you think that it just seems too coincidental that both of these movies use the same thing, and both coming from Disney, use the same trope to end their...
It's probably not surprising.
Right. I think there's a little bit of... I mean, all the same people are working on these movies. I feel like there's a little bit of, borrowing
from one to the other. And I think also was another fuck you, Rian Johnson moment as well. Because in the last movie, he's like, ask for help. Nobody came.
Right.
He had this poetic thing where, they're not. And then it's like, JJ's like, no, they come. And so he had them come anyways.
All right. So those are the big superhero movies. Somehow I've gotten into talking about genres. Oh, we didn't talk about Spider-Man. There was another Spider-Man. And there was a big deal about Spider-Man this year probably not staying with the MCU. But then it turns out...
That's fine.
It's going to be okay. Spider-Man's going to still be around for a little while.
Harlan says Joker? Neither one of us has seen Joker.
There's that superhero movie. Quote superhero. Not really a superhero movie, but we both kind of skipped Joker. And that's another one that's being, heralded as one of the best movies of the year.
I'll let you know next week because I got the screener.
Oh, cool.
I got my screener, so.
So.
You can come watch it with me.
Okay. That'll be how I watch it.
You don't pay for it. Yeah, I didn't, I was excited for it, and then I wasn't.
I will have to admit that I've come to a realization.
The chat seems to like it.
Yeah, everyone that I know has liked it.
Hopefully.
But I've come to a realization, because I know that I made a big stink about Joker this year and not seeing it. And I've come to the realization that as someone who's putting on a show like this, mm-hmm. I'm going to have to bite the bullet and see things. Like, this, it should be my job to see things so that other people don't have to see it. So
this is our 2020 mission?
My mission in 2020 is that I'm going to, even if I have baggage with something, I'm still going to allow myself to see it so that, I can report on it and talk about it. And be more educated about it.
Cinephilia. We'll watch it even if it sucks. Is that? All right.
I'd wear that shirt.
If that's the thing we're going to do.
We'll watch it even if it sucks. Especially if our audience wants us to watch it.
It's true. Because then we can have a conversation about it.
Right. We can have a conversation about it. And even if you guys want us to watch it because you don't want to watch it, then we can we'll go watch it and report back to you and go, yeah, you're right. You don't need to go see that.
Rita Cooper says, 2019, year review from Cinephilia. We didn't see movies.
I saw over 100 movies. I just didn't see some of the ones you guys love.
What's FFH?
FFH?
Oh,
wait.
For fuck hell. No, it's...
For fuck
but
hell.
But she wants FFH. It's going to be stupidly obvious, and I can't think of it right now.
Far from home. For yes. Spider-Man.
Oh, I did like Far From Home. Thank you, everybody. Not everybody's closing. Far From Home.
You liked, more than I did when we talked about it, you liked Alita, Battle Angel.
Yeah, I thought it was fun. Not amazing, but I was like, that was cool.
Yeah.
And it looked really good.
Yeah, I was going to say, there are some movies that even if I don't like them story-wise, like the things that they do for the industry, I think that one pushed some special effects for the industry in a nice way.
Very well. And it was an okay movie. Like, I was expecting it to either be amazing or it was going to suck.
Yeah.
And it didn't. It was kind of in the middle. It surprised me that way.
It did not suck by any means. Yeah. Did you see Klaus?
Klaus.
So good.
It is pretty good. It's
the Christmas movie.
Yeah, that's on Netflix. It was nice to see, like, traditional hand-drawn animation again.
But it's not. I was watching a bunch of behind... I haven't seen some of it, but I saw a bunch of behind the scenes. It's like... I have to show you the video. It's a weird hand-drawn...
It's hand-drawn, but it's done on, like...
Really cool.
It's done on computers. It's not, like, on paper.
But it's cool because they don't hand-draw the tweeners. They hand-draw the on tablets or on digital, the things, and the computer creates these tweeners. It's really cool. It's a really cool way to do... Remember I was saying that I wish Disney hadn't gotten rid of 2D animation. Yeah. They had just taken what they had and innovated. This is what Disney should have done.
And the movie looks amazing.
Yeah, because it looks great. It's got a nice digital, but handmade kind of look that I watched a bunch of trailers. I need to watch the movie now because I've seen it behind the scenes.
Just in case you don't know what tweeners are, it's short for in-between, which are the, like, an animator will draw specific, like, important poses. And then there would be, back in traditional days, there would be in-betweeners who would go in and draw all the animation frames from one pose to the other. So now we have, the digital capacity to do all those in-betweens, and you can just,
Yeah.
And it looks great.
It looks great, yeah.
What else was big in animation this year?
Will someone who hates Santa like Klaus?
I think so. It's a different take on the character of Santa. Santa is not like... Or the character in this movie is not like a happy-go-lucky, jolly guy. Mm-hmm. It's a very different take on it. So you might like this version.
Yeah.
If you are not a big fan of Santa.
On Netflix, so if you have Netflix... You can always stop and if you don't like it.
Worst animated movie of the year that I saw this year, hands down.
Yeah.
Adam's Family.
Oh.
It was awful. Oh, it was so bad. I do not recommend. And I'm a big fan of Adam's Family as a franchise. We had a whole episode on it, but that movie was bad. But an animated movie that was...
Media Pluck agrees with you.
Oh, thank you. Animated movie that actually was kind of... I was not really into it, but then it had moments that actually made me laugh out loud. Mm-hmm. Was Angry Birds 2. Surprisingly. There's a scene... One of my favorite moments in a theater was watching this scene because I was just like in tears laughing. Where, they're trying to break into... infiltrate this building, and there's like five people on this team that's trying to break in, and they decide to all dress as an eagle, like a giant eagle, and they're wearing this weird eagle suit, and all of them are inside controlling a different part of the suit, so like one person controlling the arm. It's the most ridiculous thing. It's sort of like when the Muppets did like Muppet Man,
yeah.
It's just like absurd. And he ends up, this eagle ends up in a urinal, and innuendo ensues, and it was just, like, hilarious.
I think what those movies kind of got going, like that and Trolls, is that they know they're stupid movies.
So they just, like,
go. They just go for it. And I think that's what they end up being enjoyable, because they're just stupid, and they acknowledge it. And they're like, hey, it's just for you to hang out for an hour and a half.
Yeah.
No need for awards.
And the director of Angry Birds 2 is actually the director of, do you remember the old show, Misadventures of Flapjack? Do you remember
the
show?
Name, but I remember the show.
That show was outrageous. And it's the same creator of that show that directed this movie. So his humor is there for me. It's like just absurd. And then another highlight from seeing the Angry Birds 2 movie in a theater is that the short that showed before it, Hair Love, was one of the best shorts of the year, I think. It's an animated short about a little black girl who is trying to get her hair together to go visit her mom. And it's just, it's well done. And it's nice to see, like, you know, black hair being treated as mm-hmm. something cool as well. Obviously, I'm going to be down for anything black hair.
And Mitchie says, oh, so just Power Rangers? About the Angry Birds thing.
You liked, well, I know you're a big fan of the How to Train Your Dragon movies. Did you see the third one?
I did not see the third
one. You didn't see the third one. It was actually pretty good. I would, if you're a fan of the How to Train Your Dragon movies, I would recommend it.
I will watch it. I need to get around to watching that because I do really like these movies a lot.
Did you see Missing Link?
No. And I'm also a big fan of Laika.
Yeah.
How was that?
It was...
Hitchcock says, Art, what movies did you see? We'll get to it.
Yeah, this is how we should frame the show from now on. We should base it on what Art has actually seen so we
guys,
can have a discussion.
Guys, 2020 is going to be the year.
Missing Link, as always with their movies, was a technical feat. Like, it,
yeah.
Beautifully done. I did not get into the story as much until like maybe the last 30 minutes of it. Mm-hmm. I found to be really enjoyable, mm-hmm. but leading up to that, it was just like, this Bigfoot guy is kind of insufferable. For me personally, I think other people enjoyed it a lot. So, a surprise in animation this year was that they did, I think this year they did an Invader Zim animated movie, which I actually did not miss. I mean, which I actually missed. I did not see. But it's on Netflix. I have not watched it. But they also did a Rocko's Modern Life animated movie, mm-hmm. which I did see. And I was surprised that movie was actually, like, pro-trans.
Was it really?
Yeah, Rocko's Modern Life was, like, took a pro-trans stance that just came out of nowhere, but was awesome. So I need to catch up on the Invader Zim movie and watch that and see how it, because it's on Netflix as well.
Harlaner says, Art in 2020, I saw Tron. What a great movie. Oh, it came out in 1982. Right. Kevin would say, I guess we're going to get to it, but I'll bring it up now.
You can bring up animation. Anything. Yeah, you can bring up
Frozen
anything.
2 was the most surprising animated film. My most surprising animated film. Did not expect it to like as much as I did.
I would agree. Yeah. I was surprised that that Disney as a company did what they did with Frozen 2.
Yeah, it was a very surprising film for me too as well. I didn't think I was going to... I thought I was like, yeah. Like, I watched Frozen 2 and it was okay. I didn't hate it, but I was like, eh.
Yeah.
But I watched this one and actually really, really liked it. And I think it's maybe because I already knew the characters. They just jumped into the story.
They jump into the story. And then the story itself is, like, pretty important. Like, Disney actually made a movie about what it means to have white privilege and how to use it responsibly.
Mm-hmm.
That's a major thing right now. So I have to give them props for that.
Reed H. Cooper says, Frozen had less Olaf than I expected, which saved it. But when Olaf showed up, I cried because he's horrible. I actually really like Olaf.
Olaf doesn't bother me.
I think he's super funny.
I think he was better used in the first movie than this one. Like, he kind of was just there. I mean, there's an important moment where Olaf that really I know got to a lot of people.
But I like that they used him differently.
Yeah,
which is nice because it would have been stupid to have just seen the same thing that we saw in the last movie from it. They did. And some other weird thing with them. It was kind of interesting.
Yeah. And then there's a lot of stuff in Frozen and Frozen 2 and the Frozen shorts that still goes unaddressed about what the hell actually is Elsa's powers. I mean, we get some of the explanation in this movie, but it seems like her powers are limitless.
It's like she can force.
She can do a lot of stuff. She can create life.
Apparel.
Yes, she can create. She can dress herself.
She creates life. She's creating a bunch of life.
She's all five of the elements.
I love the water horse in this mm-hmm. movie, and I always feel so silly bringing this stuff up, but I love animated hair, and the hair on that horse was amazing. Just the animation of it. I'm silly. And then also a movie that I don't think was really needed, but ended up being surprisingly good was Toy Story 4.
Yeah. That potentially just have been pretty boring and useless. Because it was kind of a useless movie.
It was kind of a useless movie. It did not have a... it wasn't needed. Like, we had already run the course. But I personally liked seeing Bo Peep return.
Yeah.
And seeing what was up with her and seeing how counterculture she became. Mm-hmm. Was just like, fuck your system. I don't need to do that. I can live my own way. I thought that was refreshing to see.
And it was kind of nice seeing seeing that Woody was no longer like a leader and kind of dealing with that, him losing his position is like and dropping down to just regular toy status. I think that was kind of a nice thing to see.
There have been a couple of themes over the last year in movies, and I think one of them that I should bring up, which has to do with that, is the passing of the torch from male characters to female characters. Mm-hmm. We've been getting a lot of movies that are this year that are just like women are important and the men can take a back seat for a moment. Mm-hmm. And that's totally what happened in Toy Story 4 with Woody. That's also what happened in surprisingly of all movies, the Terminator movie. Did you ever see that? Mm-hmm. That I think you would like that. Yeah. It really not only sets women up to be important, but mm-hmm. also people of color, specifically Mexican people. Mm. So I think you should, I mean, I'm not going to tell you to check it out just because you're Mexican, but I think you would enjoy it and appreciate it.
I just started reading a science fiction book where the main character is Mexican. I was surprised.
Or you didn't go into it knowing that?
No, I didn't go into it. Like, it's not in the description, just offhand, like, the character speaks in first person. He's like, yeah, you know, blah, blah, blah. My wife from Ireland and me from Mexico. I was like, hey.
That's cool. That's awesome.
I will keep reading this book now.
Let's see. What is another movie on the bottom of my list that needs to be talked about before we move up? There was a lot of anticipation for Scary Stories to tell in the dark.
Mm-hmm. How'd that go?
That ended up being really bad.
Yeah.
I think the problem with it was that they didn't let the stories be themselves. They tried to connect the stories into one overarching story. Like, all the characters in the separate stories are now, like, in this situation together, and it kind of loses its power that way, because then you're worried about the overarching story more than the separate stories. Mm-hmm. And it leaves it on a cliffhanger as if they're going to do more, and it's just like... They shouldn't at this point. I'm starting to... Like, I love Del Toro as a director, obviously. His vision is amazing. Everything that he produces is not so great. It's very hit or miss. There are some great things he's produced. Some things he produced just have not been that great. And this was one of them.
Rinesh Cooper says, did either of you see Jexy?
Jexy?
Yeah. Jexy and Abominable.
Oh, I did not. No. I know what Abominable is. I didn't see either.
Because it's horrendous. Like, seriously, one of the roughest experiences.
I didn't see either, so I'm glad. I mean, with that description that I didn't. Abominable didn't look that great. And also, there was a...
Oh, and it's just called Jexy. He said, I walked out of two movies since getting unlimited tickets. Jexy and Abominable.
Yeah, Abominable didn't look great. I've never even heard of Jexy, so I'm fine not having seen that.
Oh, we're going to have to watch a lot of these next year.
That's fine. The thing is, I actually enjoy watching bad movies. Maybe I'll watch them with Amber, because I know she enjoys watching bad movies. I enjoy watching bad movies because they're a lot easier to talk about. I mean, it's I should take that back, because good movies are very easy to talk about. When you enjoy something, it's very easy to talk about how much you love it. And so that's easy for me. But bad movies, it's just so... I guess because I have a shady side that I just enjoy talking about bad things sometimes. So I actually don't mind watching bad movies. My problem with watching bad movies is that I don't want to encourage the industry with my money as far as bad movies. But then I have AMC A-List, and it's kind of like, I'm actually only paying for like one or two movies a month. AMC's paying for the rest, so.
Yeah. I'm going to have to get AMC.
You should, and then we could be in an entourage. Before we get out of animated movies, since we're talking about bad movies, we might as well bring up, because there's a lot of animation in it, we might as well bring up Cats. Because that was a movie that was, for me, awful, but also awesome at the same time. Which is kind of like how the Cats musical is. Are you petting him or are you eating his popcorn? I mean, I would pet Idris Elba too, but... But you didn't see Cats, right?
No.
That was one that I had to see, even though it looked awful. I had to go see it just before they updated the special effects. Yeah. I had to see what those effects looked like before they got upgraded. They were awful. And they may be lost to time now, unless they come out with like a...
Yeah, I don't think they're ever going
to... You're never going to see those again. So that's why I rushed out to see that one in the theater.
Days in the Zone says, did you, any of you watch Dolomite? It's my name. I did not. Surprise.
Reed H... I did. And I'm going to get to Dolomite in a moment. But Reed H. Cooper is trying to call me out saying, you liked Cats, don't backpedal. And yes, I did like Cats. But like I said, it was both awesome and awful at the same time. Which is what I said when we talked about it on the show before. The acting in it is the performances are great.
No.
The set design is great. The story is not so great, but that comes inherently from the show. Mm-hmm. And the special effects are just atrocious. And I feel like I still want to see it again. I might have to wait until it's streaming somewhere. I want to see it with the updated special effects just to see how much it is improved. Yeah. So it's not bad enough that I wouldn't sit through it again. I would sit through it again. And it's, like I said before, I feel like it's going to be one of those movies that's going to become a cult classic.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone who's saying that they hate it now and in 5 years are going to be like, I actually love it. I mean, for all the bad reasons. So,
Michi says, I love that the Cats movie was shipped with all the special effects. Amazing.
Yeah, it is amazing. It's the first time that I can think of that a movie's actually been patched, which is what happens with video games all the time, where they fix bugs. I can't think of a movie that has been patched while in the theater before.
Mm-hmm. It's like I don't think.
Unprecedented. So Cats broke, you know, Cats is a groundbreaking movie in that in that sense.
It sucks so bad they had to fix it.
What was another big special effect movie we can talk about? You know what was surprisingly good?
What?
It was, I told you this already, and I know you haven't seen it, but Dora the Explorer.
Oh, I really want to see it.
It was surprisingly actually really good. Very entertaining and very, like, aware of itself. Like, it knows Dora's origins and is willing to make fun of itself,
mm-hmm.
as far as how silly the original Dora show is. You bring up a movie. What's a movie that you have seen that we can talk about? You can't even think of anymore.
What did I go see this year? You know, the thing is like right now it's when I catch up on movies because I get my screeners.
Yeah, that's true.
And then I watch all the movies a lot of the movies that I missed out. I did watch. I think this is my favorite movie of the year.
Really?
I saw Jojo Rabbit today.
Oh, that's what you saw today.
That's what I saw today.
It was a great movie.
It was such a good movie. I've never had a movie make me laugh that made me feel horrible and then immediately made me laugh again.
That's exactly what
it
does.
And back and forth, nonstop.
It's exactly what it does. And I think it is very timely in that, I don't know, I'm going to get political now. The rise of fascism is upon us again. And I think a part of that has to do with our media and our pop culture and how mm-hmm. we have looked at Nazis for however long it's been as villains in movies and comics and all that thing and all those things, but in a way that treats them as not serious, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and so somebody that could never be again, that we would never be like that.
Right. It's become like, using a Nazi as a villain has become like a parody of what actual Nazism was. And so I think that this movie does a very good thing in showing us that parody and then immediately showing us the seriousness of it, which is what you were saying. Mm-hmm. Like, it makes you laugh, and then it really digs into you and is like, oh, you really shouldn't be laughing at this kind of thing.
Yeah. There was one particular scene. I'm not give away too much.
I already know what it is.
Is it when the Gestapo shows up?
Oh, that's not what that.
No. Are you thinking? Yeah, I think I know that. No, when the Gestapo shows up.
Yeah.
And it's a really funny scene, but at the same time, you're like, you're anxious. Tense. You're tense. Because it's this really tense moment, but this comedy that's happening inside of it, and it was such a weird feeling that I don't think I've ever had in a movie.
I'm going to try to say this without giving away, but the scene I was thinking of is when he's outside and you know, it's kind of in a good mood, and then he looks up and is like, I'm just going to leave it at that.
That was awful.
It was awful.
Yeah.
It was awful.
So I would say, if you guys do yourself a favor and go watch it, I think it's still in theaters.
I believe so, yeah.
Go watch it. I think so far it's my favorite, and not because it's the most recent movie I watched, literally watched it today, but I think it's my favorite movie of the year.
Of all the five movies that Art saw this year, Jojo Rabbit is his favorite.
How many did you say? Five? Four movies?
I said five.
Five movies? 5.1, because I started The Irishman and then Game of
Thrones. Not even a 0.1, though. It might be 5.01. So let's talk more about...
DK Slurker says, it was difficult to enjoy George Arrive because it really is almost reflecting the current times.
Yes.
Especially with the rise of so much hate. Yeah. It was very much that was the point of the movie, that it was a reflection of what is happening.
But I
and
think,
it's not just in the U.S. This is across the world.
Yeah, totally.
Across the world we're having... Yeah, so...
He was very smart. Watiti was very smart in his direction of that movie. And in his own portrayal of Hitler. Hitler. He is amazing as Hitler, which is frightening to say. But
he wears blue contact lenses that are just ridiculous. Is that for the first time you see him and he leans towards the camera, they're just bright blue eyes? Oh, he's so good. He's so funny. And scary. Because then he gets scary.
Yeah. But that's what's unnerving about the movie.
You guys watch it.
So, okay, we're going to segue into movies we actually like now, since we've been talking about a lot of movies we didn't like. There were actually a lot of horror movies that I enjoyed this year, like Us. Oh, you know what? Let me go back to Dolomite Is My Name, since someone asked about that. That's probably my top comedy of the year.
Yeah.
Even though Jojo Rabbit would be considered a comedy by some. Dolomite Is My Name was interesting in that it actually got Eddie Murphy back in his prime, because he's kind of not been funny for a long time.
Yeah, and then apparently the SNL thing that he just did was apparently great and very much...
Yeah, I wanted to watch that. I did not get to see it. Him and Lizzo on the show together, but I didn't get to see it. I think
it's time for him to do what he did and not...
Eddie Murphy is making a comeback just in time to not voice Mushu in the Mulan movie. but you know, Dolomite Is My Name is great, and I actually watched it twice. The second time I was showing it to my dad, who just was like smiling from ear to ear the whole time he watched it.
Reed H. Cooper says, Dolomite Is My Name is a comedy?
I would consider it a comedy. I laughed through the whole thing. I think, it's a comedy. I mean, it's dramatic at the same time, because it's this true life story of the creation of the Dolomite movies in the old blaxploitation time period. But it definitely is tongue-in-cheek. Like, it knows that those movies are kind of silly to begin with, and it plays that up and plays with all the actors and behind-the-scenes crew. You cannot watch that movie and see Wesley Snipes in that movie and not think it's... And think it's not a comedy. His Wesley Snipes' performance in that is so over the top, but so perfect. Like, it's incredible. But it makes you laugh at the same time. So it's definitely a comedy.
Hardliner says, Coming to America's sequel's coming out next year.
That's true.
Well, yeah.
That is true. Eddie Murphy is, like, on his game right now. Another movie that I thought was surprisingly good was we watched a trailer for Peanut Butter Falcon. Mm-hmm. And I actually went to see it and was surprised at how good it was. Shia LaBeouf, in two movies this year, really knocked it out of the park.
And I was hoping to get at least one of those as a screener. Didn't get
that one and Honey Boy.
Honey Boy, yeah, that's what I wanted to see.
Everything you've heard about Honey Boy being a great movie, believe it. Like, for it to be written by Shia LaBeouf and then he also plays his father in it, mm-hmm. it really hits you. Like, yeah. it's there are some moments in it, in Peanut Butter Falcon, that are, like, straight comedy and actually make you laugh. Honey Boy just, like, tugs at you the whole time. And so he got to show a nice range this year. And I respect Shia LaBeouf a lot more than I used to.
Yeah. He's weird.
Go for him. Someone else that I respect a lot more than I used to, Robert Pattinson.
Yeah.
Was great in Lighthouse. Him and Willem Dafoe.
Lighthouse. Also another movie I didn't watch. But I really wanted to.
Well, you don't really get into horror movies that much.
But I wanted to watch that one. That one looked good.
That was one of the best horrors
of the year. I think part of my hope is that at the end of the year, I'm going to get a bunch of screeners for those movies, and then I don't. I only get, like, a few of them.
If you had AMC A-list,
I could just go.
You could just go, and you would definitely, that would get you to go to the movies more often.
I'll get it next month. I have a job next month. I can afford it.
So, on the horror front, I'm going to say, like, Lighthouse, Us, was amazing.
Us was great.
Us was great.
That was in February, right?
Yeah. Okay. That was it. You know, it used to be a thing, like, if you watch RLM, you recognize the phrase, fuck you, it's January. Mm-hmm. Because January used to be a time where bad movies would come out. Like, it wasn't a big...
Yeah.
You know, the beginning of the year hasn't traditionally been mm-hmm. a good time for going to see good movies. Like, that's when they just throw stuff mm-hmm. out. But the last few years, January and February and March, have all picked up.
I think it started with the first Deadpool that released in February. And that kind of...
What year was that?
Like 5 years ago? Okay. 6 years ago, something like that. That's when that sort of hit a big thing, because Deadpool...
Yeah.
Exploded out of nowhere, and then we're like, oh, people will come see movies. Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll come see movies whenever you put them out, as long as they're good.
I think for me...
It's not like, oh, it's March. I don't feel like watching a movie this month.
For me, noticing that change was happening was in 2016 when The Witch came out in January. Oh, yeah. And, you know, I thought... I went to the theater thinking it was going to be like a throwaway movie. It was before I discovered A24, but I went to see it and was just like floored by it. And for the entire... 2016 year, that was at the top of my list until Moonlight came out towards the end of the year. Mm-hmm. I was like, okay, so A24 is my thing now.
February 12th, 2016 is when Deadpool came out.
2016. Mm-hmm. So 2016 is the year that changed, fuck you, it's January, February, March. Yeah. Like, that's the year that started putting out good movies at the beginning of the year. Did you see Rocket Man?
I have it as a screener. I'm gonna watch it. Amber loved it. Amber saw it.
I loved it too.
Amber loved it.
I loved it too. It was a great retooling of Elton John's life.
Yeah.
And then Taron, the star of it, is just great in the role. Yeah. Like, he's acting wise, singing wise, dancing wise, he really nailed like the essence of Elton John. And it was probably my favorite musical of the year. What other musicals came out this year? Frozen and Cats. It was. I would say Rocket Man for me was definitely better than Frozen or Cats. Yeah. I can't think of any other movies that had lots of music in it. I will say, as much as I, you know, shat on Ryan Johnson for Last Jedi, Knives Out was great.
That's what everybody keeps saying, but I don't want to watch it.
It still has the sloppiness that I hate from him as a, you know, his style of directing. It's still pretty sloppy, but the point of it outweighs the sloppiness.
Yeah.
So.
Not a fan of sloppy filmmakers.
I know. But it's better than Last Jedi. for me, it's the best movie that he's made. I know Rita H. Cooper loves Brick, and he's going to chastise me about that. But I feel like Knives Out is the best movie that has come out of this director yet. And I hope that he continues in the route of Knives Out. Because
like
away
from Star Wars?
Not necessarily away from Star Wars, but more in a, not away from anything, but more in a direction of fine-tuning his, because it's not as sloppy as Last Jedi. You can see that if he chooses correctly the type of movie that he makes, he can figure out how to make his style work for it, mm-hmm. as opposed to just putting his style over anything and just making it messy. So I hope that he follows in that suit and makes more movies that work for his style. Because every artist has a style, and I'm not trying to make any artist change your style, but just find a way to make your style work. Mm-hmm. So I actually give Knives Out a thumbs up after years of talking about how much I hate his movies. Horror Noir is probably the best documentary for me this year. Mm-hmm. I've talked about that a couple of times on this mm-hmm. show, and it hits me. What else is a movie that should be talked about in the last 5 minutes of the episode? What's a Parasite. Movie that you've seen?
Parasite. Have not seen it, but I'm excited because I got a screener for it.
Parasite is in my top five, and it's definitely worth seeing.
And the only reason I haven't seen it is because I'm trying to look for like a time where I'm just going
to
sit.
You have to sit and watch it. Yeah. It's subtitled, so you have to read too. Are you okay with that?
I love subtitles.
I'm just teasing you.
I can read well.
So movies that, because I'm going to wait until we really get into award season to announce what my absolute favorite movies of the year are. So I'm not going to give you outright my top five. There may also be like other movies that I might trickle in and still watch that might hit up there. I highly doubt it at this point, but I am going to say other movies that are not to be missed, in my opinion, as other people say, Irishman and Marriage Story, you shouldn't miss it. Yeah. Movies that I think you should not miss when you get the chance to see them. I think you should see Parasite. You should see The Farewell if you have not seen it. That was amazing. You should see Portrait of a Lady on Fire, which is not available to watch right now because they pushed it back. It's not my fault. Blame the distribution. But it is coming out on Valentine's Day along with that other trailer that we watched. You should also see Atlantics, which is actually streaming on Netflix. It's a African movie, which we don't get a lot of, and it was well made. It's kind of a thriller. I'm not going to give it away, but go with it. By the end of the movie, everything will be explained. There are some points when you're watching Atlantics that's just like, I don't really get what's happening, but by the end of the movie, everything is explained and it all wraps up nicely and it's really cool. Loose is a movie that I think people should see, especially if you're a fan of Octavia Spencer or Naomi Watts. They're both great in it. And it's a really cool ensemble movie where, you know, you're aligning, watching the movie, you're aligned with one person's point of view. And by the end of the movie, you're aligned with someone else, and it switches all throughout. So it really takes you through a roller coaster ride. You have got to see, if you have not seen it, I've talked about this movie numerously on this show, The Last Black Man in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. Dave actually got me the Blu-ray for Christmas, and that was my biggest Christmas gift. That's what I was most excited for, was just the Blu-ray of this movie, because now I get to watch it again. So definitely see that. Are there any recommendations you want to give to people that they should have seen for movies in 2019?
A lot of the movies that I didn't see. But
well, you can't recommend them. You haven't seen it. No. I mean, movies you have seen. Jojo Rabbit is your favorite movie. Favorite,
yeah, that's it. Don't laugh at me. How many movies did you watch, Danny Montu?
Apparently more than you, and I'm shocked.
I'm going to give some movies that I think we're okay, but I actually would not recommend to see. So if you missed them.
Pokemon. Watch Pokemon. That was good.
That's not even the name of the movie.
Detective Pikachu.
Watch Pokemon. Just all of Pokemon. Watch it.
Gooch Kemper says, The Last Black Man in San Francisco is now streaming free on Prime.
Oh, it is on Amazon Prime. Also, Gooch Kemper, since you're in the chat, happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
It's Gooch Kemper's birthday today. So thanks for sharing your birthday with us. Actually, Godzilla was great.
Yeah, I like that.
I would recommend that. I'm hit or miss recommending It Chapter 2 or Queen and Slim. Those are both movies that I, or Midsommar. Those are all three movies that I was really excited about when they came out. And then I went to see them and they didn't quite line up well for me. They all have great aspects to them, but they all also have things that I really don't like about them. I would suggest First Love, which is a Takashi Miike movie. That was a lot of fun. Are you you're looking at my list to see what you've actually seen?
Yeah, because I might have forgotten. Always Be My Maybe, I really liked.
Always Be My Maybe was good.
That was good. Fun. That's on Netflix.
That's on Netflix.
I'm sure I forgot. There's things that I've forgotten about that I'm looking at your list.
I was really excited for the movie Monos, but then I ended up not liking that. Now we're getting down into the bad movies. I was really excited for The Kitchen as well because I really wanted to see Tiffany Haddish and Melissa McCarthy do something more serious. But then that movie, their performances are fine, but that movie just was not well put together. It's like a segments strung together, but there's no through plot line. There is a through plot line, but there's no connecting tissue for mm-hmm. those moments. So it just feels like an incomplete movie or a badly put together movie. So I don't recommend The Kitchen. I think that's our 2019 year in review. That was a sloppy year in review.
Yeah, you gotta watch more movies.
I
got it. Ryan Johnson direct this year in review.
I think I heard that, but Danny asked if Ryan Johnson directed this year in the view.
It was sloppy.
We'll do better next year, we promise.
New Year's resolution?
Do better. Watch more movies.
But do better. Your New Year's resolution is to watch new movies.
Yes.
I don't need to do that.
No, you need to watch bad movies. This is your resolution.
Look at this. Half of the list is bad.
Yeah, but some, not all of them. You refuse to watch a few of them.
No more refusing to watch movies will be my New Year's resolution. Right. I can't even say that the movies I refuse are bad. So
yeah,
I can't say that.
You're categorically just refusing.
I really only refuse to see one movie though.
Well, yeah. I didn't say there was just general. Don't refuse to watch movies. And I
you know, before I announce my favorite movies of the year, I will have seen that movie. So, who knows what could happen?
Yeah, and I will watch more movies. I'm gonna actually do that. Now, what's the app name again?
Letterboxd. Whenever we do lists or talk about a bunch of movies, I always have a Letterboxd list. Just want to close. I want to show you guys.
With a D at the end too. It's not just
boxed.
So yeah, so it's the word Letterboxd, but with without the E before the D.
Just
so
Letterboxd.
It's Letterboxd D. Letter. It's kind of like how Grindr doesn't have the E. That kind of thing. If you know what Grindr is. Yeah, Letterboxd, I highly recommend. You can make lists of all your favorite movies or whatever kind of list you want to make. You can also keep track of all the movies you've seen without making lists. So you can, it's basically a movie diary. So you can log anytime you watch a movie, just put it there and it keeps track. It gives you statistics for the end of the year. So I can
do that.
I can.
Let's all do that.
I can actually tell you some of my statistics. I can tell you since it's the 2019 year in review, I will tell you what some of my 2019 statistics are as far as movie watching.
You can also compare statistics between friends.
Yes, you can. Are you on Letterboxd?
Yes.
I did not know that.
Can you make groups on Letterboxd?
Yeah.
Maybe. I don't think you can make groups, but you can, you know, you follow people. And,
all right. Yeah. Everybody get a Letterboxd account. If you like talking about movies, let's all do that for 2020 so we can chat about it.
So my statistics are, in 2019, I watched 729.6 hours of movies.
I thought it was 728.6 movies.
No, I watched a total of 458 movies this year.
Jesus.
105 of them were new 2019 movies.
I think I literally watched a total of 8 movies this year.
Yeah. And the first movie I watched this year in 2019 was Apocalypse Now. My most watched movies for the year, I watched horror noir 3 times because I kept talking about it. I watched Dora the Explorer 2 times, which is actually, it was actually 1.5 times because the first time I watched it, I was on a plane and I fell asleep. So I actually rented it to finish watching it. And that's how I know it was good. I watched Dolomite Is My Name twice, as I said already. I watched Coco twice, which was not a new 2019 movie, but I did watch it twice this year. My most watched star actor of the year is Keanu Reeves. My most watched director of the year is Bong Joon-ho.
Yes.
And they were both people that we did episodes on, so it was a lot of research done.
I missed the iTunes sale on his movies.
Oh.
Because they're all like, all his movies are like $2.99.
I found that there is a streaming service called Popcorn Flicks.
Oh, yeah?
I had not heard of this before, but Memories of a Murder is streaming on Popcorn Flicks.
Oh, cool.
So, if you want, it's a free streaming service, so.
Mitchie says, so glad we have Art here to contribute to all of his knowledge on movies. I don't think it's about movies.
So, other big directors that I watched this year. Bong Joon-ho is my top director. I watched 7 of his movies this year. Brie Larson also ended up on my top directors list.
Oh.
Because I watched one movie, which was...
The
Unicorn Store on Netflix, but also 2 shorts that she did as a student, which were actually pretty interesting. And then after Keanu Reeves as my top, I watched 12 Keanu Reeves movies this year, which is a lot.
Dang.
Samuel L. Jackson is my second, which, you know, I was purposely watching Keanu Reeves movies for our show.
Yeah.
So I, you know, put effort into watching movies for him. I did not put any effort into watching Samuel L. Jackson movies, and he's in so many movies that he ends up, you know, number 10.
In all the Marvel movies.
And then my third top is Tom Hardy.
Because you like watching
Because I love Tom Hardy. So, yeah, those are some of the things, some of the stats that Letterboxd give.
Swedish Cooper says, wait, 12 Keanu Reeves films? Yep.
You want to know which ones? It will tell me exactly which ones. I watched this year, starring Keanu Reeves, I watched The Matrix, Exposed, Toy Story 4, he was in that, Always Be My Maybe, he was in that, A Walk in the Clouds, Man of Tai Chi, My Own Private Idaho, A Scanner Darkly, John Wick 1, 2, and 3, and Much Ado About Nothing.
Wow.
So that's 12 Keanu Reeves movies.
Wow.
So yeah, I highly recommend Letterboxd, and going into a new year and starting fresh with the letterbox is a good thing.
Cool. I will do that.
Cool.
All right, so I don't have a recommendations button yet. Recommendations for the end of the year.
I just gave a bunch.
No, like something else.
Something not from 2019? Is
no,
that what you
yeah,
want
not,
to say?
Not related to...
Not a 2019 movie that I would recommend.
Yes.
Let's see. You go first.
So, I like buying games on Switch and then never play them, but I buy a lot of them. This one I actually started playing, and it's really good. It's called The Tourist. It's a very, very cool game. It's really hard to explain. It's this little dude who goes to an island, and then this mystery stuff happens. It doesn't really explain a lot to you. You just kind of end up on this island, and you have to figure out and unfold this mystery by yourself. It's a very nice, like, retro, like, it kind of looks like Minecraft-y, like, little boxes. All the characters made out of little boxes and stuff, and it's really cute. It has very, very nice... music, and I would check it out. If you have a Nintendo Switch, I would check out The Tourist.
The Tourist.
It's really good.
On Nintendo Switch.
Yeah. I'm really into indie games right now.
You know what my recommendation is?
What?
That everyone come celebrate New Year's Eve with us.
Yeah, come celebrate New Year's Eve with us. It's either going to be amazing or terrible. We have no idea because we've never done it before.
It could be like Cats and be both.
It could be both, yeah.
It could be both.
We'll be singing.
There will be singing.
Yeah.
I can wear my cat ears. I mean, I have those. I'm not going to wear a full cat suit, though.
Okay. yeah, so come join us tomorrow. We will be here. And look for the button, second person. We'll be here starting at 7 p.m.-ish. We're going to have friends here. We're going to have fun. It's going to be pretty relaxed. It's kind of half planned. We actually had a meeting, but it was like 10 minutes.
You don't have to tell your audience all that. You
just the word's transparency. I wanted that's to make sure true. They know what they're doing.
Transparency is always
good. No, it's going to be fun. It's really fun. We're going to hang out. It's really our first hangouts, big long hangout stream, similar to like the studio days that we used to do here, that we've done here. Aside from like, I guess, the build for the tavern. But if you guys have nothing to do, you're hanging out, if you come hang out with us. We'll be here with a bunch of friends, a bunch of faces you've never met. Because we invited like regular friends, non-streaming friends, to come hang out. And we'll be here next week. And the Perception Check is here back on Wednesday. Yeah?
Next week we're doing a decade in review.
Yeah.
And I'm going to outline it so it's not sloppy like today.
He's looking straight at me when he said that.
You need to, you should, when you're putting your letter, you should put your letterbox together before the next episode.
Oh, that's a lot.
Because you can look and see what movies you've actually seen. I will
do
so
that.
You will know what you've seen.
I will do this week. And I will also make sure I upload both episodes of Cinephilia this week. Last week, she's The Mist, even though Will texted me a bunch of times to do it.
But we, both of us have also, like, outside of Perception, had a lot of stuff to do. I, you know, was helping a move. My partner Dave moved in with me. Yay!
Is he done?
Mostly done.
Cool.
And then you were up in, y'all were all up in Big Bear.
Big Bear.
So there was a lot of reason why, you know, we weren't focused on that.
Yeah.
It's
Christmas week.
It's the holiday. Yeah, it's holiday. Christmas and New Year. So
cool.
We get a little slack right now.
Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll
see you later.